Hi, I'm Meg. Welcome to my LUMOplay tutorial. LUMOplay has a lot of really cool templates that you can use to customize your own effects and games. In the description of this video, you'll find links to step-by-step tutorial guides for each one of our templates, information about our pricing, and information about how you can download LUMOplay for free. Anything that you make with LUMOplay will work on any touchscreen or with any commercially available 3D camera. You can use any kind of display, but projectors are the most commonly used displays with LUMOplay because they're very affordable and super flexible. We created LUMOplay to make it easy for teachers and artists and designers to make interactive experiences using equipment that they can source locally, find easily, and in some cases that they already have. If you need help choosing your equipment or any help with your setup, you can contact us at info@lumoplay.com and we'll be happy to help you. Please don't forget to like and subscribe and share this video with your friends. I'm trying to prove to my network that projector nerds can be very popular on the internet. Now, I know that you clicked on this video because you want to learn how to make an interactive wall game. So let's get started. If you're making a wall attack game, you're going to need a background image or a video loop, some enemy characters, a life indicator graphic, so usually that's a heart or some sort of indicator in the corner to show how much life is left, start and end screens, a portal graphic, which is something that shows where the enemy is going to spawn, and some particle images so that the enemies react when you hit them. You can always use default graphics that come with any of the templates for your game, so if you just want to customize it by throwing a logo on it, that's very easy to do. But it's really fun to customize all of the elements in the game. I could make all my images from scratch, but lately, I prefer to save my creative energy to sew weird birds. 123rf.com has a great vector stock library. I'm making a Halloween interactive game, so I'm going to pick a background with a haunted house. This picture even has trees in the foreground that I can use for a mask. I did a quick search, and in no time, I found some characters that look like jerks. I think they're going to be good enemies for my game. My life icon is going to be a skull to match the overall aesthetic of the game. The last thing I need is my little portal graphic and a fun title design that I can use to create my start screen and game over messages. I'm also going to need some audio. I use Upbeat, and I'll choose a background audio loop and some sound effects that will play when the enemy characters get hit. I need to do a bit of work to prepare the images for my game. The background horizon line needs to be in the middle of the screen or higher so the enemy characters look like they're popping out of the ground. I also need to resize the image so it matches the screen size for my game. I need to make sure the characters, life indicator, portal, and title elements are all the correct size for the game, which is ideally the maximum size you want them to be on screen, or even a little smaller. When I'm done editing my stock vectors and exporting the layers that I want, I import them into Photoshop to double check the sizes and create a nice working file with all of my elements on named layers so I can export them easily to the final PNGs. This is a personal preference. You can export transparent PNGs directly from Illustrator, but I find that if you use clipping masks, it can make the sizes really inconsistent. This might be a me thing. I took one course on Adobe stuff in 1996, so it's best not to take Adobe advice from me. Hopefully, you're younger and hipper and you're using a less evil design software. If you are, and you want me to make a tutorial using something other than Adobe, feel free to share your preferred design software in the comments, and I'll take a crack at it. To make the game, I'll launch LUMOplay, choose the wall attack template in the Motion Maker section, and add the graphics and audio that I've prepared. I've done this a few times, so I know exactly how to prepare my graphics so they'll work in the game. If this is your very first time, you should expect that you're going to want to adjust some things once your images are imported the first time. Also, before you get started, you may want to flip over the audio section and quickly mute the audio so you don't go insane. Overlays are non-interactive elements that float on top of your game, and they include a logo and an idle image, which will appear when no one is playing. I'm not adding either of those images to my game today, but you certainly can. The mask layer with the trees and the life indicator image will go in the first section, which is where all the overlays go. The life indicator image should be a square image. It'll look stretched in the template toolbar, but it will be sized and oriented properly on your game. I have asked to move the life indicator into the score section because it makes more sense there. So by the time you're watching this video, it may be something that you upload a little later on. Keep in mind that anything you add to the overlay section will cover up anything else in your game. So if there are elements like a score or life counter that you want to remain visible, you have to make sure that you design your mask overlay so that it doesn't cover those up. You will also definitely want a well-designed start screen. When someone interacts with this screen, it will start the game, so this is the best place for your game title and your start button. I've also added a try again button to my game over screen. This screen is not interactive, and it will just appear at the end of the game for a few moments before resetting to the start screen, but I like to add a button image here to keep people from walking away when a game ends. It lets them know they're free to keep playing. It's up to you if you want to add this. In an event where you want to get lots of people through an experience, it might not be ideal, but at a play center, it can encourage kids to stick around while the game resets so that they'll keep playing. If you'd like me to make a video about how you can design a game for a specific behavior, let me know in the comments, because this is definitely a topic that I have a lot of opinions about, and I'd love to make a video on this subject. The background image goes behind everything, and it should be the size of your game screen, so you should find out what the resolution of your installation screen or projector is going to be. Most of them are 1920 by 1080 or 1920 by 1200, but if you're using a 4K screen, then the resolution will be higher. A background video loop can add even more life to your experience than a static image. You can even add audio to your background videos to create really dynamic soundscapes. For this game, I'm just going to use a simple image. Adding characters is my favorite part of making a wall attack game with LUMOplay. I delete the default characters and replace them with the new bad guys and with the portal image. This is your chance to play with all the fun settings until your spawn rate and size and movement speed are exactly what you want. You're likely to spend the most time on these settings and test a lot. It's important to know how this game's going to be played if you want to get these settings right. A really fast spawn time and movement speed will work well on touchscreens, but might be really frustrating in a wall ball setup, which is what I'm building. I'm going to balance the movement, spawn rate, and size to make my game a challenging experience for players who will be throwing balls at a big wall projection. Particles are shapes that act like the goo your enemy character becomes when they get hit, and you can have a lot of fun with them. I normally make mine 20 to 50 pixels tall and wide, but you can definitely play around with bigger or smaller particles. There are some sliders to adjust how the particles behave too, so you can make a big splat or just a little sploot, whatever you think is appropriate. I'm a big splat kind of person. I recommend using an audio loop that is 1 to 3 minutes long and has a start and end, and it isn't too repetitive. Since this song will be playing throughout the game and even when the game is idle, you should listen to it a bunch of times in a row before you commit to it. Sound effects are very easy to find for free and you can easily make them yourself. A lot of our game sound effects are just my co-founder Kurt yelling. Once you've added all your elements, it's time to test your game. If you don't already have your interactive system hooked up, you can test the game on your screen like I'm doing here. But if you really want to know how the game's going to perform in the final installation, you should connect your design computer to your projector or whatever display you're using and plug it into a camera. Save your draft and calibrate your system so that LUMOplay recognizes your projector and camera. When you relaunch your draft motion maker game, you'll be able to test it in your full installation. This is an ideal way to let your client try the game and request changes before you pay to publish the game. If you have a Lumo Playmaker license, unlimited publishing is included with your subscription. Just press publish to remove the watermark and publish your game. Once it's published, your game will work in all the Lumo Play licenses in your account, but no one else will have access to it. If you're using LUMOplay Free or Playground, there's a small fee to publish the game, which is linked in the description below. That's it! You've made a game! If you've watched to the end of this video, thank you! If you have any questions, feel free to email me at info@lumoplay.com or leave a comment below. I answer all the comments, I answer all the emails, and I'm very happy to help you. Please don't forget to like and subscribe. It really helps us out. We don't have a marketing budget and we sell our software at cost because we want to make this technology as affordable as possible for small businesses and schools. So your support means a lot and really helps us out. I'll be back with a new video next Tuesday.